plan, he hath appointed us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one things, gather in one all in Christ. Let me read that again. He might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven, which are on earth, even in him. Notice that in the dispensation of the fullness of times. Now again, I just wanted to point that out, that the word dispensations are not biblical. Sure they are. There it is. He talks about an old dispensation, new dispensation. The old dispensation, old covenant. New dispensation, new covenant. Basically what you're dealing with is the Mosaic covenant, which is called the old covenant, and the new covenant, which Christ, you know, gave us on the night of his crucifixion. I mean, on the eve before his crucifixion, and he sealed it on the cross. But there are actually multiple dispensations that I'll show you. There are multiple covenants. There are many covenants throughout the Scripture, but there are seven major covenants between God and man. And so that's what we're going to be talking about here in our discussion today. And so what I'm going to do just for a moment, and I'll eventually hopefully get around to your chart for a minute, but I'm going to talk about three different things in this class, basically. We're going to talk about ages. We're going to talk about dispensations. And we're going to talk about covenants. Now, we have a class here, I've already mentioned, that is called God's Covenants with Man. And we talk about these seven major covenants of the Bible directly. So when that class comes up, hopefully you'll take it because it's a great word. And even though there are similarities between these two courses and they intersect to some degree, they also stand on their own. The covenants class focuses on covenants while mentioning dispensations. This dispensation class here, the God's Plan for Man, focuses on dispensations while bringing in and talking about covenants. And so it's a broad subject. As a matter of fact, we could stand 10 of these courses, actually, and still wouldn't exhaust the subject. Just for a moment, let's talk about this, because we're going to talk about, when we talk about ages, dispensations, and covenants, ages have to do with changes in the earth. Changes in the earth. I'm going to talk about, and I'll do this brief because this is not the bulk of my study, but it's interesting and it's important to the overall view of the study. One of the things I like about the chart is that the chart kind of gives us sort of a bird's eye view of God's plan for man. And so when we step back and look at the chart, basically, if you step back, you'll see from eternity to eternity, eternity to eternity. And so what you have between the two eternities, because God is the eternal God, God lives and operates in the eternal realm. He is, you know, the eternal God. You and I, when we're born again, receive eternal life. And so it's that you have it. But eternity is where God lives. It's the reality. Time is like a bubble in eternity. God created time for us. The evening and the morning were the first day. There's time. And so everything you see on this chart is basically pertaining to time, but it's also pertaining to God's overall plan for man. I'm going to mention this again a little bit deeper in a moment, but I'm going to mention it here because we know what God's initial purpose, perfect plan and purpose for man was, because he created Adam and Eve in the garden, created a perfect, and a perfect God, created a perfect man, placed him in a perfect world. He gave them dominion over all the earth, told them to subdue the earth, conquer the earth, that kind of thing. And they were doing great until they sinned. Once they rebelled against God, God expelled them from the garden, and then he put a cherubim there with a flaming sword and would not let them enter back into the garden. Then, and that's in chapter 3 of Genesis, pronounced curses on them, and that set us into a plan B. You and I are in a plan B right now. That plan is called a redemptive plan. We've been in that plan for years, thousands of years now. And it's all going to come to a close in Genesis, in Revelation chapter 22, verse 3, when the Bible says there will be no more curse. The curse came in Genesis chapter 3. The curse will end in Revelation chapter 22 and verse 3. If you miss that, you just missed the whole of the Bible. Missed the whole point. If you get that, then everything in your Bible will immediately start taking on some sense, making some sense. And that's what we're going to be talking about in this course. So in that, we see five ages. We see seven major covenants in the Bible and really nine dispensations. Two dispensations of eternity. We're going to talk about a dispensation here and a dispensation over there of eternity. And then seven dispensations of man. So I'm going to come back and talk about that again in a few minutes after we build a little bit in your notes. But here's what I want you to think about. Ages have to do with changes in the earth. If you look in the scripture, you see five major changes in the earth. Five major changes in the earth. I'll talk about those, and they'll come up again here in just a few minutes. Just remember, ages have to do with changes in the earth. Five times the earth changes. Several times the earth will be destroyed. We know that the earth is going to be destroyed by fire. Peter makes that clear in 2 Peter chapter 3. And John says we'll have a new heavens and a new earth, so we know the earth is going to change. We know the earth was flooded in Noah's day, so there's a change. We know that the Lord is going to come back and set up his earthly kingdom on the earth, and he'll right all the wrongs, and we'll have a theocratic rule of Christ. There's another change. So there are major changes in the earth, and so we'll talk about those five changes in the earth for probably about a third of a lesson. Dispensations have to do with allocations of time. Allocations of time. When we think about it, the word dispensation comes from the root word dispense. So let's think about it like this. You go in the restroom, you wash your hands, you get a paper towel out of a paper towel dispenser. So it is an allocation of a paper towel. And so what happens is when we talk about dispensations in the scriptures, dispensations are allocations of time in which God gives man the opportunity to walk out his covenants that he makes with man. And we look into the scripture, there are seven major covenants of God with man. There are a lot of covenants in the Bible, but there are seven major covenants between God and man. Covenants have to do with relationship. So it's on the basis of a covenant that God actually enters into a relationship with man. It's always on the basis of a covenant. We're living today in what we call the new covenant. We just referred to a moment ago what we call the Old Covenant. That's also called the Mosaic Covenant. It was given to Israel coming out of Egypt. God brought them down to Sinai, made a covenant with them. That's called the Old Covenant, sometimes called the Sinaic Covenant, sometimes called the Mosaic Covenant. But there are seven covenants like that in Scripture, beginning in the garden with the Edenic Covenant, the Adamic Covenant, the Noahic Covenant, the Abrahamic Covenant, the Noahic Covenant, or the Mosaic Covenant, the Noahic Covenant, Mosaic Covenant, the Davidic Covenant, New Covenant. We have seven major covenants in the Bible. It's on the basis of covenants that God establishes relationship with man. God didn't do anything outside of that relationship, because that's the relationship. That's what establishes our relationship. Every dispensation begins with a covenant. The dispensation of innocence, where we'll start with in a little while. The dispensation of innocence, when God created Adam and Eve, placed them in the garden. He created two innocent beings, placed them in the garden. The dispensation of innocence began with the Edenic covenant, the covenant that God made with Adam and Eve right there in the garden, when he made a covenant with them that they would conquer the earth, they'd subdue the earth, that they would spread out on the earth, and those kind of things. They broke that covenant, and so God made a new covenant with them in Genesis 3:15 called the Adamic covenant. And so we're going to see seven major covenants, and these covenants establish the relationship between God and man, and then this dispensation allows man a period of time in which he walks it out. Some of those dispensations are numbered up front, like the dispensation of the millennial kingdom. That's 1,000 years. We know it up front because God says, I'm going to give you I'm going to do this in 1,000 years. Some of those we don't know. We don't know how long that particular dispensation is. And so we look back, though, in history, and we can see that some of the time frame on some of these dispensations can be numbered in arrears, but we don't always know the time frame up front of the dispensation. But it is an allocation of time. It's a time frame in which God allows man to walk out his terms. Now, there are these seven major dispensations in the Scripture. It doesn't mean that there are seven plans of God. There's only one plan of God. It's this redemption plan. Exactly right. We're in a plan of redemption, but what covenants do and what dispensations do is they progress man's relationship with God all the way through history. So if we start looking at the Bible as one plan, both Old Covenant, New Covenant, Old Testament, New Testament, and we see that God is doing one thing. He entered into a relationship with man in the garden, man botched it, sin, and God is putting it back. Eventually, we're going to go right back to where Adam and Eve was before they sinned in the garden, to that kind of earth. But everything in between there is built on these covenants and these dispensations in which God is progressing his plan throughout the Scripture. If we see that one plan, it's a redemptive plan of God. Now, I probably ought to write it on the board because I think it's probably healthy. Everything is redemptive. Everything that he's doing. So when we look in the scripture, it's always redemption. From Genesis 3 to Revelation 22 and 3, it's always about redemption. That means it's always about Christ. There's one theme running all the way through your Bible. It's always Jesus, whether it's Old Testament or New Testament. I know somebody said, well, in the Old Testament, they were saved by keeping the law. No, they weren't. The New Testament makes it clear. I was reading in my class the other day, and I read a quote from Clarence Larkin, who actually drew the drawings on the chart, and then another guy put them together in chart form. But Clarence Larkin, who's passed on many years ago, but Larkin gave a point, a quote. He said that the New Testament is enfolded in the Old Testament, and the Old Testament is unfolded in the New Testament. It's a good way of looking at it. Everything in the New Testament is already mentioned in the Old. My grandpa was a Bible teacher, and I remember as going over there when I first started ministry, and even before that, he would always, you know, he'd go over and his whole room, it looked like a cyclone hit. He'd have books everywhere, and he'd have, you know, chairs in there and exercise. I remember going over one time, he had books propped up on the exercise bike everywhere, and I said, well, you're not using that thing unless you guys already read them. But he had just stuff everywhere, and if you touch one of those books, stop that! You know, don't turn that page. That was way before computers. And so, man, if you turn the page, you take you have to read 200 or 300 pages to find that thought in you, you know? And see, they have it all over the floor. You have books out there. But I remember when I was going over there one day, and he said to me, he said, if you can only have one book in the Bible, what would you choose? And I said, you got that down back. Matthew or John, one of these New Testaments. He said, it's wrong. He said, you wouldn't choose those, he said, because that would give you only a tiny picture. He said, look over there on the big. I have it now. He's passed on. I have his Barnes notes. And he said, look on that Barnes notes set over there. And he had a lot of commentaries. He said, tell me what's the biggest commentary.
Daniel.
And it was Genesis. And so I went through and I looked and I thought, you know, most of them have one volume. Genesis had two huge volumes.
Yeah.
And so he said to me, he said, you know why? He said, because everything in the Bible is covered in the first 50 chapters of the Bible in Genesis. He said, so if all you ever had was Genesis, you could live right. You could have a great relationship with God because it's all enfolded there. That was his point. Everything, when you start thinking about it, types and shadows, it all shows up. Jesus is all over the book of Genesis. Starting in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, the seed of the woman is going to crush the head of the serpent. There you have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. See?
Yeah.
And so it's all the way through. And so he pointed it out. And so it's so true. So that everything in the new is enfolded in the old. And everything in the old is unfolded in the new. So we need to go back and forth and see these things. And so that's what this course is going to do. It's going to take you all the way through from start to finish, from Genesis all the way to Revelation. We'll be covering throughout the course, and I think you'll find it to be helpful. All that being said, let me read your introduction, and I'll get started, and I'll come back and talk about all this as well. I know I'm talking 90 miles a minute, but you know, I'm trying to get to at least a certain place today. Introduction. In discovering God's plan of the ages, it is important to understand the various ages and dispensations that proceeded from eternity past throughout history and into eternity future. The American Heritage Dictionary defines an age as, I'm quoting here, a period of time marked by the presence or influence of a dominant figure. So when you think about an age, now this isn't just a textbook definition of an age, but we're pointing out the fact that the ages, as it pertains to our study, have to do with changes in the earth. So we're going to call an age has to do with the earth. And when we talk about the dispensation, we're going to be talking about man. As used in Scripture, it denotes a certain time, a period of time, or a season. A dispensation, and I'm quoting here, is a specific arrangement of or system by which something is dispensed. The divine ordering of worldly affairs. In Scripture, the term dispensation means an administration or stewardship. That's an easy way to think about it. An administration or stewardship. We think about it right now. We're in our country. We're in the Obama administration. Prior to that, we were in the Bush administration. Prior to that, the Clinton administration. And so we understand that that means that's their term of office. They want to get things done in their administration. That's how we need to think about these dispensations, and it'll help us. So it's an administration or a stewardship. The reason, though, I like the word stewardship is because God gives it to us, doesn't belong to us, but he gives us a stewardship over it. You and I are operating as, in effect, co-workers and co-laborers, as Paul said, with the Lord. So God gives us responsibilities, and we're accomplishing his purpose on the earth, God working through us by the Holy Spirit. And so it is a stewardship, that whatever ministry, whatever call God has given you, He's given you a stewardship over that. And to be honest with you, we're going to give an account for it one day. We'll stand, not before the great white throne judgment, only the wicked are going to stand there. But the righteous are going to stand at what, you know, Paul calls, before what Paul calls the Bema, the judgment seat of Christ, and we'll give an account. And every man, you know, his works will be tried by fire, Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And so we know that we're in this stewardship. It is the ability to discern the various times and dispensations that will assist us in understanding the particular responsibilities and conditions placed upon man in each period. It is important to remember that each period progresses into the other, and that's an important point, progresses into the other. We don't start and stop. But each one of these dispensations progresses us a step forward in God's plan. So each period progresses into the other, and each works together to complete the ultimate purpose and plan of God. In this first lesson, we simply hope to provide an introduction, that's all we're going to do today, into various ages and dispensations that will be discussed more fully as we proceed deeper into our study. So that being said, before we start talking about five ages, I want you to go over to page 10, if you will. Page 10. And I think our page numbers are the same. Does your page 10 say what is meant by the term dispensation?
Yes.
Right, that's where I'm going to start here just for a moment. Remember, we already said that an age is a period of time, and we said that an age has to do with changes in the earth. We said a dispensation is a specific arrangement or system by which something is dispensed. It's the divine ordering of worldly affairs. So when we talk about dispensation, I gave you a couple of definitions here. Easton's Bible Dictionary says the method that has been dispensation is a method or scheme according to which God carries out His purposes towards man. The Holman Bible Dictionary says that a dispensation is an administration, ministry, or stewardship for which a person has responsibility in God's administration of salvation. In certain interpretations of Scripture, like ours, a period of time during which people are tested in respect to their obedience to a specific revelation of God's will. Now, I know you're wondering, why did I jump all over here? When I rewrite this workbook, and I'm going to do it eventually, I'm going to fix all that, and I'm not going to start on page 10, but I found it easier to teach this way. So I gave you Finest Deck's definition of a dispensation. I like his. I think it's a good one, so I'll read it. This term dispensation, Deck says, refers to a moral or probationary period in angelic or human history during which God dealt with angels or human beings according to a particular test or responsibility, under which each was to remain true to his trust of administering affairs for God under his direction. That's why it's called a stewardship. The word dispensation itself comes from two Greek words. It's the word oikonomia, but it comes from two different Greek words. One is oikos, which is house, not yogurt. Oikos, house, and the other one is nomos, which is law, or house of law, or basically administration, householder, so to speak. When we think about the New Testament, I'm not going to read all these. New Testament usage of the word, you know, you see it there in your notes. A lot of different passages that talk about, dispensation. And I'm not going to go through those because they're there in front of you. It's sometimes translated to stewardship, so there are other times that the same word, oikonomos, shows up as stewardship under numerous terms, and sometimes the word steward. So let's take just a moment to understand dispensational thinking. I put your notes in the Scriptures, the term dispensation refers to a moral or probationary period in history. I know all this is just stuff, but it's going to make sense. It's going to really take shape in a moment. I like Scofield. He said a dispensation is a period of time during which man is tested in respect to his disobedience, to his obedience to some specific revelation of the will of God. In other words, it goes back to what we said. God makes a covenant with man, and then God tests man to see if man will operate according to the covenant. We know that we're going to see that man fails every time. I'm going to point out. That's why I gave you that little chart. We're going to see it. But it's not about failure. It's about progressing the will of God. I want you to see it. So I put in your notes, Scofield lists three important concepts when we talk about a dispensation. He says a dispensation implies a deposit of divine revelation. It implies a stewardship of divine revolution, and it involves a time period as well. These are three things that we're going to be focusing on and off all through our study. So I put in your notes, each dispensation is unique, and God has a different purpose for each dispensation. We're going to talk about seven dispensations of man, two of eternity, and there's a specific reason for these dispensations. God has a specific purpose. If we miss those, we miss the whole point. We miss the whole point of Scripture. And we'll wrongly divide the Scripture instead of rightly divide it, and we'll be confused about the Scripture. And it happens all the time. I hear people today teaching things that pertained only to a previous dispensation that really didn't have any bearing on us today. And they teach it as if it applies to us today. I hear them say all the time, all the blessings of Abraham are mine. Well, the Bible says that, that Jesus died on the cross, that the blessings of Abraham might come on the Gentiles. Mm-hmm. But then they run out and say, all the blessings of Abraham are mine. Does that mean your wife's going to get pregnant at 90? I hope that's your blessing. I'm mine. Amen. Hallelujah. It'd be easier for me, it wouldn't be for her. And so that's not our plan. Neither are you going to have a seed, and his name's going to be Isaac, and out of him all the seed families of the earth are going to be blessed. So when you hear that kind of stuff preaching, I'm not being critical, but these are people that are they're wrongly dividing the word of truth. They grab a verse, and it sounds good, and they run out and teach it, but it doesn't apply.
Right.
Maybe a principle of it applies, and they should teach that principle, but the scripture set does not apply to us. And so what we need to do is find out how it applies and why it applied there and what God was trying to accomplish, not only in that time frame, but the big picture, because that's what we're getting. That's why I love the chart. We're teaching the meta-narrative of scripture, the big picture, not just an isolated something God was doing in any given dispensation of time, but the big picture. What's he accomplishing? What's the big purpose here? And we want to be big picture people. We want to understand the plan of God. We don't want to just operate in a little vacuum in one little area somewhere. And people tend to do that. They find their place and they like it. They stay right there. They never move forward. God's called us to know the big picture of what he's doing. We want to see it and understand it. So each dispensation is unique. God has a different purpose for each dispensation. Therefore, I put your notes, God's purpose and man's responsibilities vary from dispensation to dispensation. There's no question about it. They vary. The responsibilities are going to change. We're going to talk about each of those responsibilities in every dispensation. And it's going to help us to rightly divide the word of truth and understand not only to rightly divide, but understand the big picture, what God's accomplishing overall in his plan for man. So what applies to one dispensation may or may not apply to the other. Now, in no way are we teaching that, you know, there's different means of salvation or different, you know, measures of salvation. We're not teaching that at all. All we're saying is, it's always by the blood of Christ. People are saying Old Testament, New Testament, by the blood. Everybody in the Old Testament saved because they observe the types and shadows, and all those types and shadows pointed to Christ who would eventually come. You and I are saved by looking back to Christ who did come, but it's always by the cross. There's only one way. Jesus said, I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So if you're Abraham and you're making a covenant with God and you're looking ahead to the Messiah and you're offering sacrifice and, you know, in hopes of Messiah would come, then you're in covenant with God. If you're standing over here on our side and you're looking back to Jesus and you're operating in the new covenant, you're trusting Christ for your salvation, you're in covenant with God. And so it's always by the blood. There's only one plan. But the dispensations have unique responsibilities, and each dispensation applies only to that dispensation for the most part. And again, it's designed to be progressive, to move us all the way forward to one day when we're going to see the Lord come back and rule and reign over the earth for 1,000 years. We're progressing to that place. And so we'll talk about that. In Finest Dates book, and you're not reading Finest Dates, not everybody's reading Finest Dates, maybe some will, but he gives 9 important points necessary in understanding each dispensation. Now, if you know anything about Finest Dake, I'm long-winded. I don't doubt that. Amen. I'm notorious for that. Proud of it. Hallelujah. I'd rather be more long-winded than short-winded. I'd rather have too much to say than not enough. However, I just want to point that out. You know, there is a positive to it, you know. But Dake is really long-winded. I mean, he makes me look short-winded because this man is... he's scholarly, and he sort of fleshes it out. One of the things about Dake, though, is he tends to flesh too much out, from my perspective. Mm. He complicates it because it's just how his mind works. Mm. He was like a genius, I think, in his day. And so when I agree with everything he said. I disagree with a lot he said. However, Dake can take 4 points and make it into 8 in a minute. And that's what he's done here, from my perspective. He's given us 9 points that you can read. I'm not going to read them. But I've summarized it and sort of condensed it down, and I've condensed it down into 5 points necessary in understanding each dispensation. That takes us back to this chart that I've given you right here, because these are the 5 points that I want you to know about each dispensation. If you know those things, you'll have it down pat. You may not understand everything, but you'll understand the gist of these dispensations, and it'll be a blessing. So whereas Dave has, you know, all these 9 points, I'm going to condense it down to 5, and I'm covering exactly the same material he is. I'm just giving you a short order for it. Every dispensation begins with a favorable beginning. Every dispensation begins with a favorable beginning. That favorable beginning is a covenant. A covenant establishes relationship. So whether we're in the Edenic covenant or the Adamic covenant, the Noahic, the Abrahamic, doesn't matter, whether we're in the dispensation of innocence or conscience or dispensation of law, it always begins with a covenant, with a relationship between God and man. This relationship establishes, this covenant establishes that relationship between God and man. So the favorable beginning of the dispensation of innocence is the Edenic covenant. You see it on the chart. The favorable beginning of the dispensation of human government is the Noahic covenant. So on and so forth. Every dispensation also, what you'll discover, has a test and a purpose. There's always a test, and there's always a reason. Dave breaks that into two, I break it into one, because there's a test and there's a reason for the test. Man is tested in every dispensation. You and I are being tested today. God entered into covenant with us and started a new dispensation, and yet God's testing us in every dispensation. Tests are not a bad thing, it's a good thing. James makes that clear. That we're tested to stretch and to build our faith. Every dispensation has a test and there's a reason for it. So the test and the purpose of the dispensation of innocence was obedience and abstaining from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That's what God told Adam and Eve to do. They didn't pass the test. They ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and sinned, and so you and I are in this mess today because of them. Amen. Think about it. So it's true. Yeah? The test and purpose of the dispensation of human government was obedience and accountability. The test and the purpose of the dispensation of promise can be summarized. You know, obedience and relationship. We can go through all of those. There's always a failure. Man's always tested. God always makes a favorable beginning, makes a covenant with him, starts on pristine ground, perfect soil, and yet man is always tested, and man always fails. We're failing in this generation. We're failing in this generation. We'll talk about it. The failure of man in the dispensation of innocence was the fact that he ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil as God had asked him not to. The failure of the dispensation of conscience was, you know, allowing his conscience to be corrupt. By the time you get to Genesis chapter 6, after God makes a brand new covenant with man in chapter 3, by the time you get to chapter 6, the Bible says the thoughts of man's hearts are only evil continually. So he violates his conscience over and over. The failure of the of man in the dispensation of human government was disobedience and man's unwillingness to subdue the earth. The Tower of Babel is the whole purpose for that. It's one of the things that you'll see as well. If you look at this chart, some people look at a chart, man, that's a mess. It looks like it. You know, I mean, it's pretty in all these colors, but what it kind of looks like is like you took a bunch of stuff and just flung it up on the wall and some other stuff. It's kind of what it looks like, you know. But all of these are stories in the Bible. These are major events and stories in the Bible. And when you look at it, you've got Adam and Eve in the garden, Cain slaying Abel, and Noah and the ark. Abraham, you know, slaying or willing to offer Isaac, and the Exodus from Egypt, and the tabernacle, and Jesus being baptized, and the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the book of Revelation, and the tribulation period. All of these are major events. The bottom part of the chart is Daniel, and the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw, then the images that Daniel saw, and then you have all these underworld, departments in the underworld, paradise, and Tartarus, and the abyss, and hell, and all of these things show up on the chart. But what you need to realize is, and if you haven't realized it, is that everything is a running theme. Everything is interrelated. God didn't just give us a bunch of stories that are just spastic and unrelated. Every story is related to the other. There's one theme in the Bible. Whether you're talking about the Exodus or whether you're talking about Isaac being taken up on the mountain, it's always teaching about the finished work of Christ. That's the beauty of this. No matter where you are in the Bible, the theme is always Jesus. Even in Numbers, Exodus, Leviticus, all of that fat and blood and guts and stuff in the book of Leviticus, all of that stuff speaks to us of Christ and his sacrificial death on the cross. There's always one major theme in the Bible. Always, no matter where you are. Don't get distracted. Even Ruth, the book of Ruth, Christ is the theme. Always. Numbers. The book of Numbers. Christ is the theme of the book of Numbers. And so there's always this one running theme. So all of these stories in the Bible pertain to this one running theme, and that is Christ's redemptive plan for mankind. From Genesis 3 to Revelation 22 and 3, there's one thought, one theme. And once you get that, And once you understand these different dispensations and all the things we'll talk about, then suddenly the Bible just becomes incredibly understandable. It's what we must know. It's sort of like the foundation of all the things that we're talking about. So all of these, you know, basic points about each dispensation are important. So you have a favorable beginning, test of purpose, failure. There's always a judgment in every dispensation, and then there's always a restoration and a provision. God always brings man around. Every time there's judgment, judgment is corrective, not punitive, and God is correcting man, bringing man back to maturity in himself. Now, all of that being said, I've got about 20 minutes that I can teach on this. I'm going to deviate from the notes. I'm going to come over and I'm going to talk just a minute or two about these five ages. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to do an overview. And I say this again, and I don't say this like I think you're like all tore up about it, but I always have people kind of get tore up. They go, man, that's a lot of stuff. I can't learn all that this quarter. No, I'm not asking you to learn all that this quarter. What I want you to know are those five points that we just covered. Once you get them, the things that I'm teaching will suddenly kind of just unfold. And when you pull that little chart out that you got and like this, and you look at it, it'll all just fall right back into place. Trust me, I've taught this probably 20 times, and it's always the case. And so don't think, I don't want all that to... And maybe it's a little slow today, a lot of information, but it's all going to come together, so just bear with me. But I want to talk about five ages, and then I'll talk about basically nine dispensations and then seven covenants to kind of get us started. Two of those dispensations are dispensations of eternity. But let's start off. We have the ages, and we're going to talk about this first age, which is the anti-chaotic age. This I'm going to talk about probably week after next. So this will be a sort of a heavy drink because I'm going to get into a theory. I'm going to teach truth, but I'm also going to get into theory about where the fallen angels came from. Where are the demons? I disagree with the fellow on the chart. If I were to draw this chart, and I did on the one I have at home, I whited this out, and then I drew this down to here, because the fallen angels that are in Tartarus, that Peter talks about and Jude talk about in 2 Peter chapter 2 and Jude verse 6, come from Genesis chapter 6. The fellow that did the chart, he would disagree with me. He's the scholar. I'm just a Bible teacher, but I'm telling you, he's wrong here. Amen. But nonetheless, I respect him highly, obviously. But I think he's wrong about this. But nonetheless, where do the demons come from? Well, that's a good question. Paul, you have these evil spirits in the Bible, these demons. They come out of this period here called the anti-chaotic age. How is it that the earth appears to be, by all scientific research, that the earth appears to be millions and millions of years of old, and yet there's only 10,000 years of recorded time, all the way back to Genesis chapter 1. We're going to explain all that. I'll take the time. We'll talk about it. That'll probably be week after next. We'll get to it maybe at the end of next week, but the week after next, I'll spend a lot of time on it. And so it comes from this anti-chaotic age. You don't have to agree with me on this. This is my theory. It's not mine. It's a lot of people's theory. But I believe it, and I teach it, but I teach it as a theory because there are different opinions about it. But it's the anti-chaotic age. Before the earth became chaotic. In Genesis 1, the Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And verse 2 says, and the earth was without form and void. Without form and void, those two words mean indistinguishably ruined and wasted. Well, so we know that God created the earth indistinguishably ruined and wasted, except Isaiah 45 says that God created the earth not indistinguishably ruined and wasted, that it became indistinguishably ruined and wasted. And Jeremiah tells us how it became indistinguishably ruined and wasted, by the fierce anger of the Lord, angry at what happened here on the earth. I don't want to get into this today. I didn't even mean to go this far, but just so I can explain myself. There was an angelic age prior to man on the earth, I believe. That's why I call it dispensation of eternity past, which is a dispensation of angels. And then we have a dispensation of eternity future, which is in the new heavens and new earth. But we'll go back to here. I believe that, and Isaiah talks about it, Ezekiel talks about it, a time when Lucifer ruled over the angels and led an insurrection against God, and he was cast out of heaven. Jesus said, behold, I saw Satan fall as lightning quickly from heaven. That during this period is when I believe the earth became chaotic, and then God restored the earth, and then placed man on the earth, and that's why when you get to the Garden Lucifer has already fallen. And God says to man, I want you to replenish the earth and conquer the earth, but I want you to guard and protect the garden. Guard and protect from who? From Lucifer, who had already fallen before God placed Adam and Eve in the garden. So long before Adam and Eve were created, Lucifer had already rebelled, he and the other angels. And these are the evil spirits or the demons that we talk about today. We'll explain all of that in much more detail. Probably 2 weeks from today, we should be there by that time. But that's the anti-chaotic age. If that's true, the earth was destroyed in some way, and the earth became chaotic. And it's hard to deny that, because Peter talks about when the earth was standing in the water and out of the water. Jeremiah talks about the earth becoming indistinguishably ruined over and over. And so there's a change. Changes in the earth, that's what ages have to do with. You can, if you don't agree with me, it's fine. You don't have to do that to pass the course. If you want to be wrong, you can be wrong. No, you don't have to agree with me. No, seriously, you can start right there if you want to. It'll be fine. That if you want to be on the safe side and agree with, you know, with a lot of folks, you can start right there. But once the earth is restored, then you have what's called the antediluvian age. Anti meaning before, deluge, the flood. The age before the flood. Adam and Eve were placed in the garden until the day of Noah's flood was one age on the earth. The earth was flooded in Noah's day. We know that. And so after the flood, the Bible says Noah came out of the ark, made a covenant with God, and it launched a brand new dispensation called the dispensation of human government, but it also launched a brand new age called, typically by scholars, the present age. It's where we are now. We'll be there all the way till we get to Revelation 19, when the Lord comes back, sets up his earthly kingdom on the earth for 1,000 years. And you have a 1,000-year theocratic rule of Christ on the earth. Revelation 20 makes it vividly clear. I mean, it's just vivid. And so the Lord's going to rule and reign. You and I, the Bible says, will rule and reign with him for 1,000 years on the earth. At the end of the 1,000 years, during which time the devil's going to be bound to the bottomless pit, the Bible says he'll be loose in the bottomless pit. He'll go in the four corners of the earth to seek many. And then fire will come down to destroy them, because they'll rally against Christ and the saints. Mm-hmm. Then John said, I saw a new heavens and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth are passed away. Peter in 2 Peter chapter 3 describes it as the earth is going to melt with fervent heat. So we know there's going to be another change in the earth. So we have the anti-chaotic age, the antediluvian age, the present age, the millennial age, and then this final age, which is the age of ages. This is the new heavens and new earth. 5 changes in the earth mentioned in Scripture, and they're important and they're worth noting. We're going to talk about 2 dispensations of eternity, just brief. I already talked about one of them. This would have been the dispensation of angels, where angels actually fell, because no doubt about it, they're fallen before Adam and Eve show up in the garden. That's crystal clear. Nobody can deny that. Ezekiel 28 and Isaiah 14 tell us exactly how they fell. They fell because of the pride of Lucifer, who led a rebellion of the angels against God. Revelation 12 talks about it as well, that a third part of the angels rebelled against God and they were cast out. Those are the demon spirits that we talked about, that we'll be talking about periodically through our course as well. So we have a dispensation here. That dispensation of the age of ages, that's another eternal dispensation. The Bible says there'll be no need for the light in the new heavens and new earth, because God will be the light of that city. So time as we know it might change. But we go back to 7 dispensations of man. We're going to run through these real quick. 7 dispensations. Now we said a dispensation has to do with what? Administration. Dispensations is a dispensing of time. Because of you're walking out the terms of the covenant, and covenants have to do with relationship. So on every dispensation, God establishes a relationship with man. When God places man and woman in the garden, the Bible says God makes a covenant with them right up front. Doesn't call it the Edenic covenant. The Edenic covenant is what people have tagged it by, because it was a covenant that God made with men in the Garden of Eden. But God made a covenant with Adam and Eve. They were to subdue the earth, to conquer the earth. They were to spread out on the earth. They did none of that. They were to eat from the trees in the garden. They were not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, which they did. And when they did, then they rebelled against God. And you know, the Bible says that the devil said to Eve, "Won't you eat this tree?" She said, "You know, we can't eat that tree." He says, "Why?" She said, "Because God says the day we eat of it, we'll die." And he says, "You won't really die. God knows in the day you eat of it, you'll be as gods." And the Bible says when she saw the tree was good for food and a tree to be desired to make one wise as gods, she took the fruit, ate it, gave it to her husband. He ate it, and they rebelled against God. And so that's where sin began. And that's where the Edenic covenant ends. But in the garden, God made this Edenic covenant with Adam and Eve, and that starts what we know of as this dispensation of innocence. Man is entirely innocent. He's created only with the knowledge of God, not the knowledge of evil. They're sinless. The Bible makes that clear, that they were sinless prior to their sinning in the garden. And so it's called the dispensation of innocence. It carries us from the moment that Adam and Eve were placed in the garden all the way until they sin, and then they're expelled from the garden. In Genesis chapter 3, the Bible says that God says, you know, lest man be like one of us, and unless he eats of the tree of life and lives forever in a sinful state. It's what Genesis 3:21 says. We have to drive him out. So God drove man and woman out of the garden, put a cherubim with a flaming sword in every direction to guard the entrance to the tree of life. That's what Genesis 3 says. You can read all this, and it's in my notes, and so you can backtrack it. And then God drove them out. When he drove them out, then in Genesis 3, he shows up. He makes promises between Adam and Eve, between himself and Adam and Eve. And he also pronounces curses. The curses are part of what we refer to as the fall. The promise is that the seed of the woman is going to crush the head of the serpent. Genesis 3:15, the seed of the woman is going to crush the head of the serpent. So God makes a brand new covenant with Adam and Eve called the Adamic covenant. Right there in Genesis 3:15. And that launches a brand new dispensation called the dispensation of conscience, because now man not only has the knowledge of good, he also has the knowledge of evil. So now he's going to have to decide, am I going to follow what God wants, or am I going to follow what I want? And it's called the dispensation of conscience. Conscience comes from two words, con, which means with, and the word science, which means to know, or the ability to know. So man now has the ability to reason, and God's going to hold him accountable for his actions. And so that's what happens in the dispensation of conscience. The dispensation of conscience takes us all the way to the flood. Because by the time you get down to Genesis chapter 10, the Bible says that man has gathered themselves together around this tower called the Tower of Babel. Lots of different ideas about the Tower of Babel. Some people think, well, the Tower of Babel, you know, they were trying to build a skyscraper so tall that they could just go right into heaven. That's not the case, because all God had to do was just sit back, wait on them to get about 20 to 30,000 feet up, and they would be frozen solid. They would suffocate. You know, that's why on an airplane, they pressurize the cabin, put in oxygen, and if it, you know, they put the little thing that comes down, if all that changes, because you can't breathe up there. So God could just sit back and say, "What's this, boys? What have you got?" And eventually, all the reason. So that's not what the Tower of Babel was about. The Tower of Babel was the Scripture makes it clear that it was a tower that they got. They said, "We're going to build a tower so tall that if God decides to judge the earth again by flood, think about it." That we can get up into this tower. So what happens is this dispensation of conscience carries us all the way to the flood, which I about missed. It carries all the way to the flood. And in Noah's day, and the Bible says, and I mentioned this a moment ago, that the thoughts of man's hearts were only evil continually, and so God flooded the earth. I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about that. I don't have the time to really talk about that now, because that'll get into big discussion. But over in Genesis chapter 6. That's where these angels from Tartarus come. So, but nonetheless, you can read about it, it's here on the chart. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, Jude verse 6. But what happens is the dispensation of conscience brings us all the way to the flood, where the thoughts of man's hearts were only evil continually. God brings Noah out of the ark, spares Noah, floods the earth, destroys the Nephilim. We're going to talk about all of that in a few weeks. And then launches a brand new dispensation called the dispensation of human government. Started by this covenant, which is the Noahic covenant. The Bible says, first thing when the flood waters subside, Noah comes out, he builds an altar, he sacrifices to the Lord, and God shows up and makes a new covenant with man called the Noahic covenant, with the sign of the bow, the rainbow, which God said, every time you see the rainbow, you'll know that I'm not going to flood the earth again. When you and I see the rainbow, the reason you see the rainbow is because the clouds open and the sun's hitting just right, and you see the prism there. You see the rainbow. Every time, it started to rain, they must have been paranoid after being flooded. They realized, like, well, in North Carolina, when it starts to rain, you just want to think it's going to be only 5 or 10 days. You know? That's the way I always get it. The clouds are coming on, it's almost 5 day rains. But nonetheless, that's the way it does here, you know? And so, but what happens is when they see the rain, God says, you see the cloud, you know that I'm not going to destroy the earth. And so they did. But when you come to the Tower of Babel down to Genesis chapter 10, what happens is you get to the tower there, and you got to do a little extra biblical reading because the scripture didn't reveal it all. But history says that Nimrod told them that he led a rebellion against God and said, if we build a tower so tall that if God floods the earth, we can get up on top of the tower and we won't be flooded out. And so they're building this tower all the way up into the heavens, and God comes down and confounds the languages. And why would he confound the languages? Because in his covenant with man, his purpose, his responsibility was to spread out on the earth, to subdue and conquer the earth, to take responsibility and take authority over the earth. Man hasn't done it. They're gathering together here at the Tower of Babel, and not only that, they're gathering together themselves against God. And so what happens is God brings he confounds the languages at the Tower of Babel. And it's there, that's in chapter 11 of Genesis. And then chapter 12, that brings you to the end of the dispensation of human government, the Noahic covenant. And then you come to at the end of chapter 11 there, at the Tower of Babel experience, the Bible says, then God opens chapter 12 by selecting Abraham. He makes a covenant with Abraham called the Abrahamic covenant, in which God says, I'll start with you, because the Bible indicates that all the earth are idolaters at that point. That's what drove them up into the tower against God. They've completely violated all their relationship with God at this point. Remember we talked about these failures, open failures. So what happens is that God handpicks Abraham and says, I want you to get out from your family, away from your country, to the place that I've called you to, and I'll make a covenant with you. God's separating him. Joshua chapter 24, verse 2 says that Abraham's family were idol worshippers. And so God says, I want you out from your family to the place I called you to, and God makes a brand new covenant called the Abrahamic covenant, and launches a brand new dispensation that I've called the dispensation of promise. The chart calls it family because it's Abraham's descendants. God makes this brand new covenant with Abraham, launches a brand new dispensation, carries us all the way down to Egypt. Abraham's descendants, remember, under Joseph, are sold into slavery to Egypt. Joseph, sold by his brothers into slavery, and then he brings his whole family down there because of the famine, and they live in Egypt. They prosper for 100 years, and after that, the Egyptians become fearful, and they persecute them for the next, basically, 300 years. And they begin to call on the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They remember the covenant that God made with Abraham. And so when they do, God honors the covenant. God brings them out of Egypt, down deep into the Sinai Desert, and in the Exodus, and he makes down to Mount Sinai, and he makes a new covenant with them called the Mosaic Covenant. It's also what we typically refer to as the Old Covenant because it includes the law, the priesthood, the tabernacle, the sacrifices. Exodus chapter 19, God makes a brand new covenant with man, and that launches a brand new dispensation called the Dispensation of Law. This dispensation carries us all the way to the cross, all the way to Christ. When you come to the New Testament, they're living under this dispensation under this dispensation of law and under this Mosaic covenant, also called the Old Covenant. Jesus, on the night before his crucifixion, says to his disciples, "With desire, I desire to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." And he enters into a new covenant with them. He calls it the New Covenant. That launches a brand new covenant here. I want to go back just for a moment and talk about this dispensation of law, because in this covenant that God made with with Moses and Israel here, it was all about the tabernacle, the priesthood, the sacrifices. Because in that tabernacle, priesthood, and sacrifices, it all speaks in typology, types and shadows of what Jesus would come to do. So God is teaching them all through the Old Covenant. He's teaching them about what Jesus would do when he came to fulfill the Old Covenant. They missed the whole point. By the time you get to here, just like in every dispensation, their failure, Jesus comes, they totally ignore him. Even though Caiaphas, the high priest's son-in-law, which is totally absurd, because the way it works is the oldest son of the high priest becomes the high priest and the high priest dies. But Annas is a hand-picked Roman high priest. He's not even legitimate himself. And he didn't have a boy. He didn't have a son, so he named his son-in-law high priest. And so you got two high priests at the time, Caiaphas and Annas. Nonetheless, Caiaphas recognized Jesus as the Son of God and the Messiah, and yet they completely denied him, hung him on the cross. So what happens is there's failure in every one of these dispensations, but the Lord makes a brand new covenant called New Covenant with the disciples just before his death in the morning or the next morning on the cross. And so we launch into what we know of as the New Covenant and this dispensation of grace. This fellow calls it the dispensation of the church, but some people call it dispensation of grace, and so do I. He calls it the dispensation of the church. But nonetheless, here we have the dispensation of grace. That's going to carry us all the way until Jesus comes back to the earth the second time. He came the first time, you know, in his incarnation. He's going to come back to the earth. Revelation 19 says he'll come back. Heaven's will open. He'll come back, set up his earthly kingdom on the earth, and rule for 1,000 years. We're going to fail in this dispensation of grace. Our responsibility in this dispensation of grace is to trust Christ alone for our salvation. But man, people won't do it. They like works, and they want to trust works. And look at all the stuff we're doing today that's taking us completely away from trusting Christ. And so we're going to end this dispensation with a failure. And so what's going to happen is Christ is going to come back, set up his kingdom on the earth. We won't have a new covenant because the new covenant is the last covenant. But Christ will come back to the earth and set up his earthly kingdom on the earth for 1,000 years, and we'll enter into this dispensation of the millennial kingdom. Which brings me to the covenant that I intentionally omitted, which is way back here. And it's the Davidic covenant. After the Mosaic covenant, prior to the new covenant, you have the Davidic covenant, in which God made a covenant with David, and he promised David that in his seed would the Messiah come, and that he would sit upon the throne of David, and of his kingdom and government there would be no end. That's what Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, 1 and 4 says. So what's going to happen is, we know that part of the covenant that God made with David was fulfilled in David's time through Solomon. But half of those promises have not been fulfilled because they're messianic promises. And so when Jesus comes back to the earth, he's going to fulfill this Davidic covenant. So the Davidic covenant actually launches the millennial kingdom, if you want to think about it that way. And so this Davidic covenant is the Lord ruling and reigning, as Isaiah 9 and 6 promises. This is one of the reasons Israel struggled, is because Jesus came. He looked like the Messiah, seemed like the Messiah. Then he started talking about dying, and it really confused them because he's supposed to rule and reign on the earth. And so they got confused about it. Well, what they didn't see was this gap between that. But we know he's coming back to the earth. He died on the cross. He resurrected. He's coming back again. He's going to come back one day, set up his earthly kingdom on the earth, and he'll rule for 1,000 years, during which time the Bible says in Revelation 20 that the devil will be bound to the bottomless pit. We'll have a theocratic rule of Christ on the earth. You and I, the Bible says, as the resurrected, redeemed, are going to rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years on the earth. This is why our being obedient now is important. This is why we'll stand before the beam of the judgment seat of Christ. Because we, in effect, are training for reigning. If we're faithful over the small, Jesus said, I'll make you ruler over many. The greatest among you will be the servant of all. And he will rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. At the end of the 1,000 years, there'll be people who will live throughout the tribulation period. They'll go into the millennial kingdom in a natural body. You and I will be in a glorified body. And so what will happen is, when the devil's loose, they'll follow the devil, many of them will. They'll lead a wide-scale rebellion against Christ. All this is in Revelation chapter 20. They'll lead a wide-scale rebellion against Christ. All this we're going to talk about in detail. This is what we're talking about in the next 6 weeks. Next 12 weeks, I'm just reviewing here, just overviewing. So what's going to happen is the devil's going to go to the four corners of the earth to deceive many. They'll rally against Christ and saints to overthrow him. One final insurrection of Lucifer. And the Bible says that fire is going to come down and destroy him, that the devil's going to be cast in the lake of fire. Then John says in Revelation 20:11, I saw a new heavens and a new earth. For the first heaven, no, I'm going to go back. I'm forgetting the white throne judgment. Revelation 20:11 says, I saw a white throne descend from God out of heaven, from whose face the earth and heavens fled, and they were all resurrected. The wicked will be resurrected. They'll stand before the great white throne judgment. They'll be sentenced to the lake of fire forever. Then John says, I saw a new heavens and a new earth. Revelation 21. For the first heaven and first earth were passed away. And Peter said, and we've already mentioned in 2 Peter chapter 3, the earth will melt with fervent heat. We'll have a brand new heavens and earth. The Bible says that John said, I saw the new Jerusalem, the city of God, descend from God out of heaven. It will tabernacle on the earth with man. And God, the Bible says, will tabernacle with man on the earth forever. And there'll be no more tears, no more sorrow, no more weeping, no more crying, no more pain. Revelation 22 and 3 says, Revelation 21, but Revelation 22 and 3 says, there'll be no more curse. And so what will happen is, the Bible says, there'll be a river from that city called the River of Life. There'll be leaves on trees on either side of that river called the trees of life, whose leaves are for the healing of the nations. Remember what happened with Adam over here when he was in the Garden of Eden? He could eat from the tree of life. Once he's driven from that, he doesn't have the tree anymore. That's why people die.
That's right.
Lots of ideas about why people die. Yeah. But the reason people die is they can't eat from the tree of life. In a natural body, though, God's going to restore all of this to those who live in a natural body here. He's bringing it right back, because this is what you'll miss if you're not careful. This is what gets left out from so much of our teaching about this today. This is a redemptive plan, but this is not God's original plan.
Right.
This is a plan B. Plan A is for Adam and Eve to live on the earth, take dominion of the earth, subdue the earth, and they blew it. God's going to bring it all the way back over here. That's why there'll be no more curse. That's why there'll be trees which are the trees of life, whose leaves are for the healing of the nations. We'll have a brand new heavens and earth, and God will resume his plan that he started in Genesis chapter 1 and 2 with Adam and Eve that they botched in chapter 3, and life will go on just as it was before then. Somebody said, man, that's a long time, thousands of years. Peter said, a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, or 1,000 years is as a day. God doesn't wear a watch. Everything is not time for him. Everything's purpose. And so God's operating in purpose. And so 1,000 years just as well be a day. So to God, this is a blink. To us, it's a long time. But God is accomplishing his purpose. And here's the real issue. We'll spend some time talking about this. It's always justice. So I said, why didn't God just fix it and let us go on? Justice. Man sinned, and the wages of sin is death. And God has to rectify that. And that's why the cross. That's why Jesus has to die. That's why we trust him for our salvation, and we're justified and redeemed, and eventually the curse is removed, and we're right back to where we were there. And then we have this dispensation of eternity future, and there's your covenants. There's five ages, seven covenants, nine dispensations, seven dispensations of man. That's what we're going to be talking about over the next 12 weeks. Now, we're going to break it down. We'll spend like a week and a half on some of these, and we'll just go through each of these dispensations, and we'll flesh out all the ins and outs of it so that it all, becomes clear, and we'll discuss it each week, and, at the end of the class, I'll take time to spend some time and discuss it. But it's a great study. Amen. I hope it's kind of wet your whistle tonight. That's all we can do tonight. I've already borrowed time from you. For those of you who join us with audio, this concludes the class. Join us next time.